Okay, fine. Then I'll start with
Yes,
class
ma'am.
for today. Very good. Okay. Which is about oral contraceptive pills. Okay, this is an important topic both from your theory and Viva point of view. In theory, you can get a note on oral contraceptive pills, which may be like a long note, or you can get a short note on side effects of oral contraceptive pills, non-contraceptive uses of oral contraceptive pills, risks and benefits of oral contraceptive pills. So, and during your table Vivas also, we have some contraceptives which are placed on the table, which will be OCs, emergency contraception. So it is important that you know about it and you can answer the questions which are posed to you by the examiner. So now coming to the next question, what is oral contraceptive pill? So there are steroidal hormones used to prevent pregnancy. Now they contain hormones, estrogen and progesterone, or there may be certain preparations which come which contain progesterone alone. It's quite a popular method. It is widely accepted and failure rate is also low. Now we have different type of OCPs. Some may be a single hormone OCPs, which are called as progesterone only pills, which are generally used in lactating women, because in lactating women you can't give them combined contraception, which we will talk about later why they can't be given estrogen and progesterone combinations both. Double hormones contain both estrogen and progesterone, and they may be used in different manner. Monophasic means throughout that 21 day cycle it will be containing same hormone, the proportion of both estrogen and progesterone remains the same. Triphasic and biphasic, the combination of progesterone will vary in different cycles. High dose monophasic combinations will contain ethinyl estradiol 35 microgram plus levonorgestrel, and certain popular preparations available in the market are by the name of Malayan and Obralgi. The low dose combinations are available which contain a decreased dose of ethinyl estradiol. You saw in high dose I have written 35 microgram, in low dose it is 20 microgram plus levonorgestrel, and the trade name which are available in the market are Overal, Lloyd. These are specifically used for contraception. There are certain newer progesterone, desogestrel, gestodine, drosperinone, and the preparations available in the market with the desogestrel is femilon, that with drosperinone is yamini. It can be both used for contraception and PCOS. Now a thought may come to your mind that why do we have so many types of OCPs? If we just had one kind of OCP, it would be far better for you students to appear for the exam. You wouldn't have to read so much also. No, one of the benefit of having only one type of OCP. You agree with me? Nobody will say yes or no. Okay, anybody can just have a guess why there are so many preparations in the market. Just think, whenever we give a drug, we are trying to strike a balance between the benefit of that drug and the side effect. Okay, efficacy versus the side effect. Now for a low dose OCs, we are using Overal L and Lloyd, because ethinyl estradiol is less, maybe side effects like weight gain. You know, women must have heard, they have an apprehension to use OC, wazan bad jayega, acne ho jayenge, something like that. So we are using a low dose OCs for that, so that with the lowest possible ethinyl estradiol, the patient can prevent pregnancy. Now what is the use of high dose non-contraceptive indication? She has a bleeding disorder, irregular menses, heavy menses. It may be possible low dose is useful for contraception, but high dose may be required for non-contraceptive indication. But definitely the flip side of it is high dose will be having a higher side effects as compared to the low dose. But if she has a bleeding disorder which is greatly disturbing her and leading to low hemoglobin, we do need to give her a high dose medicine. Now why the need for newer progesterones, desogestrel, gestodine? These newer progesterones are better than levonorgestrel because they have lesser androgenic side effect, but then they have more of thromboembolic disorders. It's absolutely, if we say some androgenic side effects are less, but there will be a higher incidence of thromboembolic disorder. So you should understand there is no medicine which is without any side effect. So sometimes we use in combinations, permutations, so different kinds of drugs, or we are using it in different doses so that we may find a preparation which has maximum effect with minimum side effect. And we all human beings have different bodies also. Within normal bodies also, there may be some differences. So one drug or one type of a medicine may suit a particular individual, and she may require, maybe somebody doesn't have a proper contraception with a low dose. So she may require a high dose, and there may be some variation in weight also. There may be a lady with a BMI of 25 only, but somebody may have a weight of 50 and somebody may have a weight of 70, depending upon the height. So we are all different human beings, and what may be suitable for one may not be suitable for other. And that is why a doctor is required to be able to recommend what is the best. And sometimes if a particular thing doesn't suit an individual, when they come back to us, we try to make changes accordingly. Drosperinone is a fourth generation neoprogesterone. It is basically used in patients who may be requiring both contraception and some treatment because they have irregular cycles because of PCOS, or maybe it is a young girl which has irregular cycles and we can give her a preparation called Yamini, because drosperinone has anti-androgenic side effects. So I am just trying to explain to you why we have a gambit of different kind of OCPs, why we just don't have one only. And that is why a doctor is required to suggest to the patient what may be best suitable for her, considering her problems. Maybe if a patient has migraine, should she use a hormonal preparation for contraception, or maybe she should use something else. So when a doctor advises the OCPs, they have to evaluate whether the patient is a proper candidate for that, considering what kind of comorbidities they may be having, if they have hypertension, diabetes, etc. And that is why a doctor is required to prescribe an oral contraceptive pill. Coming to next slide, even combined oral contraceptive pills, what problem? Okay. We have different generations, depending on either difference in the doses of a drug or depending upon a different drug altogether. All of them are combinations of estrogen and progesterone. The first generation, ethinyl estradiol and noradrenaline acetate, is almost obsolete. I have not even seen a preparation in market presently. We didn't even study about it so much. Second generation, containing ethinyl estradiol in varying preparation like 20, 30 or 35, are the ones which are being used in the market. 35 microgram of ethinyl estradiol and levonorgestrel are easily available in government institutions, Mala IM, and they are free of cost. Okay. Now, as we get, suppose a combination of drosperinone can cost 300 rupees per month. So if it is a poor patient who wants to use a oral contraceptive, she can go to a government center and generally she get a second generation OCPs, which is a combination of 35 microgram of ethinyl estradiol plus levonorgestrel. As I said, then researchers further experimented to find that can we decrease the side effects in some way, and they found that there are certain newer progesterones which are desogestrel, gestodine, or gestinate. So if we use this with ethinyl estradiol, the contraceptive efficacy of those preparations remain the same, but certain side effects are reduced, which are seen with levonorgestrel. Now, desogestrel has some occasional side effects in certain patients of stroke, or I said thromboembolism. So patients may be counseled that if they find some pain in the leg, then they can contact the doctor who can evaluate them for this. Fourth generation COCs have been recently introduced. Again, you see ethinyl valerate or ethinyl estradiol 20, 25 or 30 microgram, but the progesterone type is a different one, dinogest or drosperinone. So this is very effective in patients who are having PCOS, or maybe who are having acne, because it is anti-androgenic. Suppose the acne patient wants OCPs, and she doesn't mind spending money because they would cost something like, I told you, 300, 400 per month. Then maybe this is the best possible COC for such a patient. So as we, COC's formulations may be monophasic, which means each tablet contains a fixed dose of estrogen and progestin. Biphasic, each tablet contains a fixed dose of estrogen while the dose of progestin increases in the second half of the cycle. Triphasic, dose of estrogen may be fixed or variable while the dose of progestin increases in three equal phases. So the aim of biphasic and triphasic was to decrease the progesterone so that the total amount of hormone going to the patient decreases, but the efficacy, contraceptive efficacy of the pill remains the same. However, biphasic and triphasic are not very popular, and we will be talking in details only about the monophasic pills. So coming to monophasic combination pills, as we have already talked about it, no phasic increase or decrease in the estrogen or progesterone content is seen during 21 days of the pill administration. The first pill is taken within 5 days after the start of the menses. It varies. Sometimes for contraceptive efficacy, we will start these pills on day 1 or day 2. But suppose a patient comes to me that I have heavy period starting from day 3 or 4, I will tell her to start the packet from day 5. So for contraceptive use, the day of starting a pill is generally day 1 or 2. But if it is only for heavy menses, we generally start the pill on 5th day after the start of the menses. It is important to remember how to give a pill if it is not given properly. Suppose you are there in a CHC or a PHC, a patient comes, I want to take a pill, and you say, okay, Malaen is available, you give her Malaen. It is okay, but you have to counsel the patient that you don't have to start if she's mid-cycle or she's premenstrual. You'll tell her you have to start it on the 5th day of the cycle. If she wants a contraception, you have to tell her she will not be able to read the brochure. So just by giving her, handing over that Malaen or Maladi, your work is not done. And if they do not take it in a proper way, they will have irregular bleeding, they will have unwanted pregnancies, and you will be in a soup. So doctor doesn't only have to prescribe the medicine, it is mandatory that they tell the patient how to properly take that medicine. And that is the message that I want to hammer into your mind. So you have to emphasize to the patient they should take it properly or they will have irregular bleeding and there may be increased failure rate also. One pill is taken each day consecutively for 21 days. The next 7 days are pill-free period and the next 4 starts again after the 5th day of the menses. As a doctor, you may be faced with a situation where the patient comes back to you after 2 days and said, oh doctor, I just forgot to take the first pill. Now what will you do? Or if she remembers after 2 days, I got so busy, this happened in my family, my son was not well, I was running to the hospital, I have not taken the pills for 2 days, now what will happen? So these are certain practical things where errors occur on part of the patient, they forget to take a particular pill, which also we will be discussing. So let's come to what are the questions which you should know. What is the mechanism of actions of this? When we are giving extraneous hormone, so they will remove the negative feedback of the brain and they will block ovulation. Because when there's so many hormones level, estrogen, progesterone goes down. When the level of hormone estrogen and progesterone goes down in the second cycle, there is release of FSH and LH and ovulation takes place. But in this cycle where we are giving hormones from outside, that negative, those decrease in the level of hormones will not take place. So all those release of hormones from the pituitary will not take place and thus there will be blockage of ovulation. Now this was only to explain to your mechanism how it blocks ovulation because it will inhibit the release of hormones from the pituitary. But all that you can remember for the purpose of your exam is it blocks ovulation. Progesterone alters the cervical mucus. It makes it thick, making it harder for sperm to penetrate. First of all, ovulation will not take place. Secondly, cervical mucus becomes thick, so sperm cannot penetrate. Further, there are changes in the endometrium. There is some kind of residual atrophy. So even if fertilization takes place, somehow an ovum is formed, somehow a sperm is going to penetrate, then also the endometrium will change so that it cannot support a fertilizing. So you should be remembering the mechanism of action. My emphasis in making these slides were to make it so simple and to the point that somebody asks you, what is the mechanism of action? 1, 2, 3. One line answers. You are able to give. Now, effectiveness of these combined oral contraceptive pills is expressed in terms of failure rate. failure rate means if 100 women are taking it in the first year, how many women will get pregnant? Failure rate means how many women will get pregnant if they're taking. So it is only 0.1 to 1 per 100 women years in the first year. You're getting it. So effectiveness of a contraceptive pill will be demonstrated by that in spite of taking the pill properly, if they're taking it properly without forgetting, how many people will get pregnant. And the number of people getting pregnant will be its failure rate. And the failure rate of combined oral contraceptive pill is one of the lowest, that is 0.1 to 1 per 100 women years. Okay. The other side effects which we know, which now pills have some good effects also, but then they have some side effects. Sometimes initially in the first month when a woman starts taking pills, especially with low dose pills, there may be some amount of breakthrough bleeding. She may have spotting or something. Now, if it is only some amount of bleeding in the first month, you can tell her because we are giving some hormones from outside. But as you continue to take these pills for second or third month, it will disappear. So small amount of breakthrough bleeding, which occurs initially, will disappear after she continues to take the hormones continuously. Some amount of headache and nausea, which is seen initially, also disappears on continuously taking these hormones as the body gets adjusted to these extraneous hormones from outside. Weight gain was quite a problem which was concerning the women. No woman wants to put on weight unnecessarily. So that is why we have tried to make low-dose pills. Now with these low-dose pills and neuro pills, the problem of weight gain is much less what used to be seen with Mala-N and Mala-D. But however, these are progesterone preparations. You know, in the premenstrual phase also, when we give progesterone, there can be breast tenderness, there can be mood changes. So these hormones have an effect on breast tenderness and mood changes. So similarly, some women may be more sensitive to it and may have breast tenderness and mood changes. Now see, the amount, what kind of side effect a particular individual will have and what will be the intensity of that side effect and how long it will persist will be. However, if a woman has a troublesome side effect, mood changes are too prolonged, even if she's taking the pills for 2-3 months, then maybe subsequently you may have to change the preparation. So the aim of doing all these things are that a woman may take COCs, combined oral contraceptive pills, and she started complaining of nausea. Now, if you have not counseled her that some amount of nausea is normal, some amount of headache, she will go to a physician next and say, there's something wrong with me, I'm having persistently nausea, and they will get all her LFT done, they will get all her endoscopy done. So it is important, I believe, that a doctor should be telling the patients while prescribing it, there may be some amount of bleeding, there may be headache, or you can say if you have any problems like headache, nausea, or any different symptoms from routine, please first come to me. And if I feel that you need to be shown to someone else, then we will refer you accordingly to that specialist. It is very important that we counsel the patient properly. Otherwise, they will be running, you have written a combined oral contraceptive pill, it is causing her a headache. Now she goes to a neurologist and says, I'm having headache for the past 10 days. And they don't even know that it has to be correlated to some medicine which may have been started now for some purpose. So my aim of stressing on this is that you should know how to counsel the patient that there may be some minor side effects and she can report back to the doctor after 1 month, 15 days to check whether she's doing well or she is having some problem. Actually, contraindications and major side effects can be seen. See, major side effects, we don't have a separate slide for it. But I will first talk about the minor side effects of OCPs. And the major side effects are, there may be thromboembolic disease. And hence, it is contraindicated in patients with thromboembolic disease. They, sometimes it leads to breakthrough bleeding. Hence, it is contraindicated in patients with undiagnosed genital tract bleeding. There may be some kind of heart disorders. Hence, it is contraindicated in patients with cardiovascular disorder. Some patients with these hormones can complain of migraine. Hence, it is contraindicated in patients with migraine. Some patients can have some kind of a hepatobiliary disease after having combined oral contraceptive pills. Hence, it is contraindicated in patients with active hepatobiliary disease. It is contraindicated in patients with 35 years old who smoke because it will predispose them more to cardiovascular disorders. 35-year-old smoker, obese person, they're already at risk of cardiovascular disease. So if you start giving them combined oral contraceptive pills, it might aggravate their problem. So you can, if they ask you what are the major side effects, you can say thromboembolic disorder, cardiovascular disorder, active hepatobiliary disease. And suppose the question is, what are the contraindications to combined oral contraceptive pills? Definitely you have to confirm she's not pregnant. It happens sometimes the patient doesn't know she has come to you during the premenstrual phase and you do not check her properly, do not counsel her that it has to be started on first day of the period or fifth day of the period, or she's an amenorrheic patient. And you have to take all the investigations to make sure she's not pregnant. Sometimes we just ask, she says my husband has gone some out place and there is no history of sexual contact, her UPT is negative, her ultrasound is also negative for pregnancy, it's an empty sac. So sometimes we have to take all these precautions to ensure that she's not pregnant before prescribing oral contraceptive pills. Is it clear? Can I have few yeses, please?
Yes, ma'am.
Good. You
yes,
see
ma'am.
Parliament proceedings on television. And the speaker will say how many yeses, and everybody will yeah, and how many no's. So if we hear a collective yes also, it is okay. Now we come to starting regime. So these are the considerations. When we are prescribing hormones, we have to be very, very careful. And if the doctor has not prescribed them properly, patients will suffer and they will not realize what is the cause of their suffering. If you are done away with your laughter, I'll carry on, or we can take a laughter break. I don't mind doing that either. Okay, so let's start now. So starting regimes are very important. As I said, in a woman who's having regular menstruation, we can start on day one of the cycle up to day five without any problem. However, for some reason she's menstruating and she wants no, or there is some other problem and you, based on which a clinician has to start it. Suppose she has heavy bleeding and the purpose of starting it is heavy bleeding. She's bleeding for the last 10 days. And we can give her a high dose for a oral contraceptive. But we should know that this will not have any contraceptive efficacy and she can get pregnant because the pill was not started. What else can I do? I need to start the oral contraceptive pills on 10th day because she's having heavy bleeding. Then we can add some additional protection. A condom can be used for those 7 days because the OCP was not started on time. The main thing is in a menstruating woman, OCP should be started within the first 5 days, preferably for contraceptive efficacy on day one and day two of the period. However, it may be started anytime if no unprotected intercourse, if she did not have an intercourse since the LMP, but additional protection will be required for 7 days. Suppose you are starting her OCPs on 8th day, 9th day, for some reason, my husband was outside, he has just come now, I need to start some ongoing method, now we will be, my house has now shifted here, for next 2 years I will be here. So there are many situations where women will come and discuss with you their problems and accordingly you have to see the literature and decide whether we are in a position to help her. Now in a postpartum woman, there may be two kinds of women. Those who are non-breastfeeding for many reasons, a baby must have died, there is no extraction of milk from the breast, many issues. So in non-breastfeeding moms, you can start from day 21. If after 21 days, additional method is required for 7 days. A breastfeeding moms, after 6 months also, you will not give her OCs, you will give her progesterone only pills. For breastfeeding moms, we should avoid oral contraceptive pills. There are two reasons. First, estrogen will suppress breast milk. And secondly, though till the postpartum period, there are more at risk of thromboembolism. And adding both estrogen and progesterone may predispose them to a greater risk. So for breastfeeding moms, if they ask you a question in Viva, if a woman comes to you, she is lactating and she wants some contraception, what will you advise? Your answer should be progesterone only pills. Or there are certain injectable progesterone preparations which we are not covering today, but only progesterone injectable preparations as DMPA can also be given to these women. Now suppose a woman has a miscarriage, either she gets a MTP done or there is a spontaneous abortion. If it is less than 24 weeks and she wants contraception for future, it can be started same or next day. If it is started after 7 days, then an additional method should be also taken for 7 days. If the time of termination of pregnancy is greater than 24 weeks, then you tell her to start on day 21, and otherwise if later, then additional method should be used for 7 days. Now there are certain patients who have irregular cycles, the periods come after 3-4 months or something like that. So they may be requiring both a pill for making the periods regular and also for contraception. So if a patient is amenorrheic, her last period was 3 months and now she needs, so it can be started at any time if there is no risk of pregnancy, and 7 days of additional precautions can be taken. Or we can do it the other way around. If the patient comes to me, she's having amenorrhea for some time and now she says that I'm getting a posting with my husband, I need some contraception, my periods are not coming regular, I may give her progesterone to give her a withdrawal period. So I will give her 5 or 7 days of progesterone, she will have a withdrawal meeting, and then I will tell her that when you have a withdrawal meeting, start on day 1 or up to the second day of the periods. One reason is that any can no risk of pregnancy. Now I have to rely on patient's history for that. Na? She's saying my husband is not there, I did not have any contact with him. And in very early pregnancy, UPT may also be negative. It also becomes positive when the beta HCG is 25 microgram. Very early pregnancy may not be picked up by ultrasound also or UPT also. So in that case, I am only dependent on patient's history. If I start her in amenorrhea, and God forbid if she is pregnant at that time, she will come and say, I was pregnant, you gave me pills, I had amenorrhea, so how do I know? And there she has convinced me that there is no history of contact. So to prevent all this, in my own clinical practice, if a woman would require contraception and she's coming with amenorrhea, I will give her a course of progesterone to induce withdrawal bleeding. And I will tell her after the withdrawal meeting on day 1 or day 2 of it, you start your contraception, contraceptive pills. Now coming to a situation where I said a woman has missed a pill for any reason and failed contraception can lead to pregnancy. And risk of pregnancy is greatest at the beginning and end of the pill, of the pack. They have missed it either at the beginning or end. Now if she comes to you, doctor, I've missed one pill, what to do? So you will advise her, suppose she just come yesterday, she missed a pill yesterday, night she had to take it, morning she comes to your OPD. You tell her to take the missed pill as soon as possible, let us take it now, and in the night again you take your usual pill. Now somebody says, so 2 days I was running around, I had this problem, I have missed it, 2 pills. Then again tell her that she needs to take the recent as soon as possible. You take 2 pills, one now, one evening, and then continue with it. But still, you have to write in your inner card, the risk of failure is increased because patient has missed 2 pills and she needs to use some additional contraception for 7 days. So if she misses 1 pill, maybe the need for additional contraception is not there if she remembers it as soon and then takes the missed pill. But if she has missed more than 2 pills, you should add in her card that you use additional contraception. Maybe it could be as simple as a condom for those 7 days when she has missed those 2 pills. Is it clear? Not clear.
Yes, ma'am.
Here I can go on to the next slide. So these are the problems you may sit in CHC, PHC. Okay. You may find it a bit amusing, but patient comes and says, doctor, I have 2 pills, what do you do? You don't know, you can answer anything. And if she stops her pills regularly, she'll have withdrawal bleeding. You'll say, achha, 2 pills, bhulde hai, aage bhi chhod do. And maybe she comes back with the, ab toh mujhe bleeding hone lagi, abhi 15 din pehle toh hui thi. So when you're prescribing hormones, you need to be very careful and you need to know. And if you forget and you are in a CHC, PHC, you can always go back to your books and recheck things, but don't give wrong information to your patients. It may be possible you are not routinely using this information. You can tell her to get these investigations done, call her the next day back, but go through your books and then give her the right information. So there are certain non-contraceptive benefits also, which I said, of these OCs, because the estrogen, progesterone. So polycystic ovarian syndrome. See, polycystic ovarian syndrome, generally patients present with two things: irregular cycle. This is generally amenorrhea or delayed cycles at an interval of 2-3 months. So this here we are using a combination of ethinylestrol and rosphenol. Regulation of menstrual cycle. There are three things in menstrual cycle. They're irregular. They may be more frequent. In that also, giving hormones will help. They may be heavy. In that also, it may help. Or if there is a dysmenorrhea. So again, in all these abnormalities of menstrual cycle, if there is no other factor such as infection, then giving these pills may be useful. Sometimes young girl come to us at the puberty. Now puberty started at 13. Till 14, she was having getting regular cycle. Now she's 15, and for last 1 year, her cycles are irregular. Then also we can give them these hormones, giving hormones for 2-3 months, and then we can stop it, and her normal cycles will resume. And this is a common question an examiner can ask you: what are the non-contraceptive benefits of combined oral contraceptive pills? So you should be able to at least enumerate 4 or 5, like PCOS, regulation of menstrual cycle, menorrhagia, dysfunctional uterine bleeding, and endometriosis, adenomyosis. These are 4 or 5 things which you should be able to tell. Now coming to the second kind of pill, which is progesterone only pill. So it is becoming increasingly popular, as many women worry more about the side effects and the health risk of combined oral contraceptive pills. They can be used with no age limit in smokers during lactation and for even women at risk of venous thromboembolism. Though the disadvantage is it has a higher failure rate, 0.3 to 5 per 100 woman years. Whereas if you remember in my earlier slides, I have said that the failure rate for combined pills is 0.1 to 1 per 100 woman years. So though it has certain advantages that it can be used in smokers, it can be used in lactation or something, but the failure rate of progesterone only pills will be higher than those who are using combined oral contraceptives. Now since it is containing progesterone, the mechanism of action is it mainly thickens the cervical mucus. It causes atrophy of endometrium, which hinders the implantation. It can interfere with tubal transport of ova, and there is a preparation called as cerazate, which contains levonorgestrel. So the proportion of hormone is like that, it can inhibit ovulation also in that case. So there are various composition and brand names available. So commonly we have desogestrel 75 microgram, and the trade name which is available is cerazate. So again, if a woman misses these progesterone only pills, so if a levonorgestrel containing pill is delayed more than 3 hours, and the desogestrel pill is delayed more than 12 hours, this pill is to be taken as soon as remembered. And if more than one pill is missed, only the last missed pill is taken. Next pill is to be taken as usual. An additional precaution is advised for 2 days after restarting progesterone only pills. Again, when to start? It can be started up to 5 days of menstrual cycle. If it is started later than this, additional precaution is required for 48 hours to prevent ovulation or cervical mucus thickening, so that it is effective in not preventing in preventing pregnancy. In postpartum period, it is possible patient is having amenorrhea, lactational amenorrhea, even she is breastfeeding or non-breastfeeding. So it can be started from day 21 onwards or after 6 months as a man. But for first 21 days, in the lactational phase, you will not even give her these pills also. Non-contraceptive benefit, it cannot be used to regularize cycle. Progesterone only pills cannot be used to regularize cycle. Rather, that would be the side effect, some irregular bleeding. But the only non-contraceptive benefit would be dysmenorrhea, because she's not having periods. Generally, these patients will have amenorrhea. They may have regular menses, but they may also have amenorrhea. So if they have amenorrhea, there will be no pain. So we can say the benefit of progesterone only pills could be dysmenorrhea. But then you have to caution them against the failure rate. She may be pregnant and she may be getting amenorrhea. Maybe she should keep checking her urine pregnancy test every 1 to 2 months just to be sure. I'm telling you these things because they will continue to take packs at home, and then after when she becomes 5 months pregnant, she will come and have a checkup and find it is a 5 months pregnant. So you should tell her that there is certain failure rate and there is amenorrhea. So she should be very cautious if she has some kind of a nausea or something, that she may be pregnant, and she may do some kind of urine pregnancy test in case she's not having a regular cycle. And the side effects of these pills could be irregular bleeding, weight gain, or mood changes. So contraindications of progesterone-only pills is breast cancer, which is an absolute contraindication, and if this patient has any past history of acute venous thromboembolism. So now this is an example which I am giving you. If we were having an offline class, we could interact more. What are the conditions in which you will prescribe which contraception to a patient, but this is just for an example. You have been asked to prescribe a combined oral contraceptive pill to a 26-year-old woman with acne and hirsutism, and she's also a known case of PCOS. So what is the best available option? So it should be a combination of drug which contains ethinyl estradiol and prosperinone, and it is available in the market by the name of Yamini, and this is a picture how this pack appears. Okay. And similarly, as I have said, a woman comes to you during lactation, then you will give her either Cirazet, progesterone-only pill, or you can also offer her injectable progesterone-only preparations like DMPA, which we are not covering here because our topic was only on oral contraceptive pills. Now, if we were here present offline, we could discuss more, we could have more situations to talk about. So this is my last slide for the day. Now, if you have any questions, I'm willing to answer.